And it's my great pleasure to introduce the speaker today, Denis Gaitsgory from Harvard and IHES, who will speak on the Tamagawa number formula of a function.
Thank you very much. It's great fun to be all over. Indeed, so it's Tamagawa number formula for function fields. It's a joint work with Jacob Lurie. So I'll present a somewhat simplified context. So we fix a curve, x. Yes. Smooth complete curve over function fields, over a finite field. And we fix G to be, G would be semi-simple and simply connected group. And to simplify, I'll fix it to be over the ground field. So more generally, this story works for group schemes over, actually for groups over the field of rational functions on the curve. Okay, so I'll present the formula in the way in which, well, in geometric terms. It's not the classical way in which one presents the Tamagawa number formula. So we consider bund G, the moduli space, moduli step of principle G bundles of the curve. So this is an algebraic stack over a Q. It's not quasi-compact. So yet, so if you have a quasi-compact stack Y over a Q, you can try, well, you can calculate the number of its points over a Q, but points must be taken in multiplicities. So by definition, if Y is a quasi-compact stack, this is the sum over Y, which runs over the set of isomorphism class of points, and for each isomorphism class, you assign a weight. So you take 1 over, you're taking the group of automorphisms of this point, and you count the number of points of this group over the finite field, so you sum this thing. And it's a finite sum if your stack is quasi-compact. Now, this guy is not quasi-compact, so the sum will be infinite, and one runs into a convergence problem. But it's a classical fact that this thing converges if the group is semi-simple. So our interest is, we are counting bundles. Okay, and now I'll state the Tamagawa number formula in this case.
So you said this is holds for quasi-compact stack, but now this holds more generally now?
There's nothing to hold, this is the definition.
But it converges, even
for G. It converges for this particular one.
Okay. Wasn't this a work of Kai Berendt in which he had some...
Kai Berendt,
Yeah. He worked out. This convergence is a very classical fact. It's the finite volume of the automorphic space. That's what it is.
Who worked out?
Kai Berendt. He had a way to use form power series and convergence.
Ah. But you have some implicitly the... You have the fact which that every bundle of the type considered is rationally trivial, is it true?
For simply connected, yes.
And this is somehow used to relate what you're doing to the classical form,
Yes.
But now when you were working with this more general situation of groups over the function field, the simply connected, then it is not necessary, is it?
It is.
What is?
So, I don't want to call it a set. Well, it's... Okay.
So when G is defined only over and open, then you have to extend it to the world,
case, what you do, you kind of, to state this thing, you first extend your group over the fraction field to a group scheme over the entire curve, and then you state it. Mm-hmm. So, the way I'm going to state it is specifically after the group has been extended, and that's why I made the simplification, because I don't want to go into that discussion.
And is it still true in that more general case that the bundles are rationally trivial?
Pardon me?
The fact that principal bundles on X are rationally trivial.
Yes.
Is it true in the more general context?
Yes, simply connected is true.
Ah.
But let me just stick to this case because it's much, much simpler.
Tu baisses le numéro 2.
Ah, le numéro
2. Don't put white. Mm-hmm. Ne laisse pas de blanc parce que ça dérange la caméra. Donc, tu baisses le blanc.
Ah, je baisse le.
Ouais, c'est...
state the formula, and it says the following thing, that, so, so we take this quantity, and we divide it by Q, to the following power, dimension of bound G. And I can tell you what that integer is. So, parenthetically, the dimension of bound G is G minus 1 times the dimension of the group, where G is the genus of the curve. And so, here is the formula. So, it's the product. It's an infinite product over places of your curve, the following things. Here, you'll take q to the power qx to the power the dimension of g. Qx is the number of elements in the residue field of x. I'll write it. So qx is fx, and fx is the residue field. Residue field at that point. We fix a place. And here I take the number of elements of G. Okay, so you see here Q was in the denominator, here's in the numerator. I don't like that. We'll invert. So let me rewrite this as follows. Instead of talking about G, I'll talk about BG, the classifying stack. And I'll rewrite the right-hand side as follows. Same product. I'll write in the denominator to the dimension of BG, dimension of BG is negative the dimension of G, and here I write BG, which is now an algebraic stack, count the number of points in that sense, which is exactly 1 over the number of points of G. Alright, and now you see the two things look kind of the same. So here we're counting the point number of points in bound G, and it becomes a product. So, by the way, there's also a convergence problem, because it's an infinite product, so it converges. It's an Eulerian product, and well, kind of elementary argument shows that it converges. So what you kind of deduce from this is that some idea, which is, of course, not at all true, is that bound G is, in very emphasized quotation marks, the product of these BGs. It's in no sense true, but somehow it's true at the level of counting, because the number of points becomes the same. So this is the idea that we want to realize. So it's kind of a local to global principle here that it manifests itself in the counting. Okay. So we'll attack this Tamagawa number formula by geometry, so we'll use the Frobenius. So let me remind you some very general thing. So let's again YB first an algebraic stack which is quasi-compact. So in this case, the classical formula, it's a trace of the Frobenius, growth and neglect formula, on the compactly supported cohomology of Y. So a priori, this is an L-adic number, and this is a rational number, so it's an equality of L-adic numbers. So compactly supported cohomology makes sense for algebraic stacks. So
even non-quasi-compact ones?
Well, this is for quasi-compact. Mm-hmm. So I want to apply it in the case of bund G, and there is little something to prove. In fact, this equality stays true for bund G, so that this non-quasi-compactness of bund G can be controlled. And indeed, it can be controlled. It's based in classical reduction theory.
And here there is some convergence again.
Yeah, well, so far not. This is quasi-compact. For bund G, there is a convergence problem.
No, but the cohomology, the compact cohomology dual, for smoothing a dual,
right.
Cohomologies are infinite number because of stabilizers.
Yeah, but but you always get, in this case, for quasi-compact geometric series.
Yeah, I know this from, people observe that this converges formally.
Yeah, but I mean, kind of, there's a convergence problem, but it's kind of automatically solved because you're dealing with geometric series all the time.
Okay.
So the formula stays true. Or bung G. And it's reduction theory.
This cohomology is compatible with inductive limit of these parts which are finite type. Yeah?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. I want to massage this form a little bit. So I'll tautologically rewrite this as the trace of the inverse of the Frobenius on the dual vector space to that, and the dual vector space will be what's called the Borel-Moore homology. It's usual, it's cohomology, but with coefficients in the dualizing sheaf. And so now let's suppose that this Y is smooth, as is our bund G. In this case, the dualizing is, well, it's a shift and a tate twist of the constant, so we can rewrite it even further, and we'll rewrite this as trace of the Frobenius inverse on just the usual cohomology, but divided by Q to the dimension of Y. And now you can see why I wrote this, well, because it's exactly the kind of quantity that appears on both sides. So, wants to express the following idea. And again, in big quotation marks, I want to express the idea that the cohomology of bund G, it's a well-defined graded vector space, is, again, in emphasized quotation marks, the product over all places of the cohomologies of BG. Again, it's not at all the restricted product in the sense of Adele's, this tensor product, it's not that. So, and this is what I want to assign the meaning to. So what do I mean by taking this product? So
BG, that BG index X, I suppose.
Well, my G is constant, but indeed, okay. What I think of when you look at a non-constant is BGX, of course.
I just click maps from its curves to BG, like continuous maps here. Okay.
This is an algebraic geometry, right? So far.
Still,
No, but you have x's which are closed points, but now you're doing cohomologies over the FQ bar, exactly. So okay. It doesn't make sense,
indeed. So, again, take it very, very heuristically, I will now assign sense to it. So I will make sense of the right-hand side in such a way that when I take the trace of the Frobenius, I actually arrive to the product formula as written. So that's what I will do. What is the erasure policy?
Just shift the two ones. Don't use the third one. It's easier. Just shift the number two and three.
You think?
Yeah, shift.
I trust your experience with this.
Yeah. Just since its formula looks very similar to this is Bill van Fuchs cohomology, has it a smooth manifold? It's for people in different worlds, infinite manifold.
Yeah.
It's the Lie algebra of vector fields. It has some cohomology, and it has kind of formal fields with some truncation of some nice homotopy type. You can see the space of sections, the rational homotopy type of the space of sections.
It's not an analogy. I mean, you can derive this from that.
Yeah, it's kind of.
The only problem is that. And it's actually legal derivation. I will not use it, I'll use another derivation. Yeah. What you're saying is just it's completely legit. Yeah. You can actually do it this way. Yeah. So parenthetically, in number theory, we don't really like the algebras, so that's why I won't do it this way.
Yeah, but also something called Atiyah single, whatever something here. This
Atiyah-Bott.
Atiyah-Bott, whatever.
Oh, so that product formula is,
in a sense,
I haven't defined it, I haven't designed the right-hand side.
Yeah.
Once I do, it will be the Atiyah-Bott formula, which, of course, I'll say very explicitly, but in 20 minutes, maybe. Okay, so now we'll switch to a very different type of mathematics. We'll be doing some adjoint functors, okay? Here is my x, and here is the projection for the point. I call it px. And we'll be considering the category of derived category of elliptic sheaf on x. And I'll just write to you what it means that two functors are adjoint. So here it'll be sheaves on the point. Well, same as complexes of elliptic vector spaces. And there are two adjoint functors that connect these two categories. This is the cohomology with compact supports, and this is this upper shoot functor. Yeah? Adjoint. So what does it mean that they're adjoint? It means the following. That's home in the category of vector spaces from some object F to V is the same thing as home in the category of sheaves from F to Px upper sheaf of V. Okay. So now I want to change my problem. Instead of talking just about sheaves, I'll talk about sheaves of commutative algebras. Mm-hmm. Well, what do you mean commutative algebras with respect to what kind of product? Tensor product. But what kind of tensor product? So what is tensor product? Tensor product is have F and G, you take F and G, and you pull back. That's your tensor product. However, I want to pull back with a shriek. I like shrieks better than stars, for a good reason. So this is my tensor product.
Enough tensor product.
Pardon?
Enough tensor product, compared to the
This is the external tensor product, but there are two inner products. There is star and shriek. I want a shriek. And I might omit writing this shriek all the time, but this is always the one I mean. Okay, and one can talk about commutative algebras inside sheaves on X, and well.
So here, of course, sheaves is a derived category, but I wonder about finiteness condition because in your previous talks, you had unbounded things and so on. And here, in a elliptic context, people usually consider only constructible and bounded.
Correct.
So what are you doing exactly?
So, I can tell you exactly what we do. We take the usual elliptic sheaves and incomplete. So that's the formal definition.
Incomplete of the DBC.
Yes, the DBC, yes. DBC bounded constructible category. So this upper sheaf defines a functor like this. So here are your forgetful functors that I call oblivion. You forget down the algebra structure.
So
here,
the point is you're defining what it means to be an algebra, commutative algebra, using this tensor product.
Yes, I mean commutative algebras. So this tensor product defines what's called the symmetric monoidal, symmetric monoidal structure of the category, and then it makes sense to talk about commutative algebras.
Ah, so you don't speak about commutative algebras in the highest sense.
Of course I do.
Ah, yeah.
Yeah, of course I do that.
Yeah. You do what?
No, it's commutative algebras.
Not
of course,
plane direct, not in plane direct distance problem, but kind of enhanced by spectra and.
No, you don't need spectra. It's just infinity category.
Infinity category.
Yeah, it's infinity category.
So define the what it means to be commutative, basically?
Well, just to set up.
And all the associative laws and all that stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you have to specify an infinite tail of commutativity and associativity relations. Right. And you have to disengage yourself from triangulated categories and do it in the proper higher categorical context. So, this upper sheaf just induces an upper sheaf functor of commutative algebras. But what about this lower sheaf? Well, diagram here, so let me write one down underneath it. Well, you have these functors, you can take all of their left adjoints, and the diagram will still commute. So it will be conalg. I'm not even labeling these arrows yet. Well, at least I'm not labeling those, but. So this is the left adjoint of what we had before. This is px lower sheaf. And this is the functor that actually I'm interested in. That's the what we'll be talking about. And I have a name for it. I have not a name, I have a fancy symbol for it. Integral. Okay, just for fun, do you guys know what these arrows are? What is the left adjoint to the functor of forgetting forgetting the structure of commutative algebra?
To be free.
Free. If you have a sheaf, you can create a free algebra.
Always commutative.
Pardon? Commutative. We're in the commutative world. So this diagram commutes.
Excuse me, am I a stupid question? Is there a unit in this?
A very good question. And I'm. For now, yes, but we'll soon get rid of the unit.
Oh, no.
For a good reason also, but right on. Okay, so this diagram commutes, but let me be very naive. Let me ask, would this diagram commute? So I'm asking the following question. Start with an algebra, and I want to compute the value of the left adjoint. Is it true that, and I want to compute this left adjoint and just look at the vector space that I get. Is it true that this vector space is very naively, forget down the algebra structure and take the cohomology with the back support? What do you guys think? Yes or no?
Could you repeat that?
Yeah, I'm saying, well, the diagram with free commuted for tautological reasons, because you just take left adjoints of everything. But would the following be true? Will this diagram commute? I.e., I want to compute what this left adjoint looks like. Start with the sheaf of commutative algebras, calculate this mysterious left adjoint, and then just forget the algebra structure. Will it be the same that forget down the algebra structure and compute the left adjoint?
Surely not.
Surely not. There's no reason, and it's completely, completely false. So I would like to compute this. I'll be interested in this functor. And the reason I'm interested in it is because to make sense of this fancy product. Okay, but before I try to define it, let's do a very simple case when X is a finite set, not a curve, just a really finite set. So let's solve it in this case. So X is a finite set. What does it mean to be a sheaf commutative algebras? All it means is you have a commutative algebra for each point. Okay. So I'm interested, let's call it B, this commutative algebra. So I'm trying to calculate this mysterious integral into an algebra that I call, what do I call it? A.
It's an ordinary algebra.
Yeah, I'm talking about this fancy higher category, but this commutative algebra, this problem makes sense for just usual commutative algebras in degree zero.
Yeah.
We're talking about very elementary stuff.
Yeah.
So I'm interested in this mysterious object, which is supposed to be home of commutative algebras. Well, sheaves on X, remember, sheaves on X is just commutative algebra each point from B. Well, call it PX up a shriek, but what I do, I just take this A and kind of put it on X, just put a constant algebra in each. And by definition, this right-hand side is product over X home of com alg from what I had at each point to this A. So, again, right-hand side, for each, so you have this bunch of commutative algebras, each of them is specified homomorphisms of A, and I'm looking for a commutative algebra such that...
That's a problem.
You guys are good. Okay. I'm very glad that people are awake. All right. And now we're going back to Luke's question. Take the unit out. What do you get then? Now my algebras are non-unitary. This still makes sense. Who is this guy? X is a finite set. Let's take the simplest case.
Two.
One and two. So I have B1 and B2.
Without unit, yeah.
No unit. Who is this guy?
B1 plus B2 plus B1 plus times B2.
You guys are good.
Yeah. Add unit multiplying to remove unit, yeah.
Yeah. Put the unit and you remove it.
Well, it's very satisfying to be in this audience. Indeed, a non-unital algebra is the same as an augmented unital algebra. And so you know what to do. Put the unit in, take this as a product, take the unit out. That's what you get. Perfect. Okay, if you're so good, give me the answer for general finite X.
Sum of all non-empty finite subsets.
Perfect. Okay. Okay, but that
the sum of the partial product over all subsets of X.
Perfect. Okay, but that merits a special symbol. Indeed. For a finite set, it's the direct sum. Let me call them I, all finite non-empty subsets. And for each, I'll take the tensor product over all those x's. Dx. Okay. So now, how do we want to generalize it when X is no longer a finite set? Well, it must incarnate this kind of idea, right? After all, because if we have this finite set, something like that must appear in general.
And how am I doing on time?
Still 32 minutes. Okay. So now X will be a curve, but in general, what I'll say now to define this integral, X will be arbitrary connected scheme.
But connected is important, unlike the finite set. The closest connected. And to this X, we'll assign another genetic object. It's called the Ron space of X. Ron is last name of Zilan. It's a guy in California. So, it's a genetic object.
Is it Ron?
Yeah, yes. It's your student.
Ah,
yeah.
My student.
Okay, good. Well, how do we define objects in geometry? As Grothendieck taught us, define the function of points. Home from an affine scheme S to Ron of X would be the set of all finite, non-empty subsets in home from S of X, S to X. It looks pretty horrible. So you can ask, is it representable by, see, no multiplicities here, really subsets. You can ask, is it representable by a scheme? And what do you guys think?
No.
Yeah, it's like, if it was a scheme, what would be the dimension? It's like not a scheme. So what is it? It's nothing. It's what we call the free stack. So by definition, a free stack is an arbitrary functor from, let's say, affine schemes of, well, you can say to sets, but I want more general, because I want also to incorporate bound G to groupoids, of which sets are a particular set, a particular case.
I think that in some places a pre-stack has to satisfy a part of the restriction. Not
here, none.
Ah, okay.
Just completely general. Okay, why do I want this guy? Well, because it already appeared for finite sets. And if it already appears for finite sets, I want to have it in general. And moreover, I want to have sheaves on it. So how do we make sense of sheaves on such a gadget?
Of course, it is a functor in the weaker sense of pseudo-functor or whatever. Yeah. Because yeah. Otherwise it's...
What do you mean pseudo-functor?
That is, you are not working in the strict sense of strict functors.
Yeah, I guess for me, strict functors don't even exist. Yeah, I mean, it's the function in a reasonable sense. All right. So let's talk a little bit about sheaves. Let's first talk about sheaves on schemes. So what are sheaves? Well, for me, sheaves is a functor not specify what kind of categories you consider. You can consider for now triangulated, but we'll see exactly who I have to pass to the higher world. Okay. Opposite, so i.e. to a scheme S, you assign this category of sheaves, but for a morphism, you assign a like sheaves. The sheaf will be that function. Okay, so now I give myself a pre-stack, Y. So what is sheaves in Y?
So here sheaves are what kind of sheaves are allowed?
Yeah.
In the sense of int completing and
yes.
So on.
Yeah, this makes sense without, I could do it. I could do it before int completion, but let me do it after int completion.
In categories, is it by chance the higher ones?
That's exactly. I'm leaving it ambiguous for the next 2 minutes. So you can say, you can do it either triangulated or higher, but in a few minutes I'll explain why I have to stick to higher. Not in a few minutes, in 1 minute.
That's an F upper shriek there?
That's a shriek, upper shriek. Okay, what's sheaves on Y? Naively, what's a sheaf on Y? Well, you test it by a finite scheme. To specify a sheaf on Y, you just have to specify all of its fullbacks. Naively. So this is for every affine scheme and a map little y from S to Y, i.e. an element little y in Palm from S to Y, you specify plus compatibility conditions, namely if you have and a datum of commutativity of this triangle, because Y is a groupoid, some of the equal is specified an isomorphism, to each such you specify a compatibility. F of a shriek from what you had on S2 with what you with what you have on S1. And compatibility for twofold compositions. For S1 to S2 to S3. But such a thing has a name. So this to say for each blah blah blah, there's a word for it. In other words, what we're saying is that sheaves on Y is limit over what we call affine schemes over Y opposite of the functor shv.
And if you define using, instead of f upper shrek, just f upper star, you must get something equivalent, isn't it? Because you have a smooth atlas, smooth...
No, nothing is smooth. Y was completely arbitrary.
Arbitrary stack?
Pre-stack.
Ah, pre-stack.
Yeah. Ah, you get a different theory, they are related, but it's a different gadget.
So why is an object like that?
Pardon me?
Why is an object like that?
Why is an object... Luckily, we still have it.
Yeah. So for an algebraic stack, without even infiniteness condition, just locally.
For algebraic stack with smooth atlas,
yes,
you will get an equivalent definition.
Ah, okay, this is what I thought. Okay.
But for something like the round space, you will not get an equivalent definition. Not at all, actually. All right, but now comes the moment to explain why I actually need higher categories, because, well, it's a well-known fact, it's a very bad idea to take the limit in triangular categories. So it's ill behaved. You will not be able to compute anything. So for that reason,
could you use what do they call them, derivatives instead? Derivators.
I don't know.
Derivateur. So is it one of the
some intermediate machine which was studied in Paris? Yeah.
My understanding is derivators are sort of like derived categories. They allow you to do limits, but they don't have all the stuff of higher.
So I don't know, because I don't know what these are.
Ah, they're really very nice.
Yeah.
It's one of the lessons Grotendieck sort of did, I think.
Yeah, there are several series about derivatives.
Yeah, this is Max Grot. Who's,
so I don't know. I know that...
But is this larger series kind of modern or modern?
I know.
It's less explicit, yeah. But
So we've got this. Now, let me just introduce a couple of more pieces of notation of what you can do with this. Kind of by definition, if you have a map between pre-stacks, by which we mean a natural transformation between these functors, it's built into the machine that you have an upper shriek functor. Pull back. You can ask, does this upper sheet function admit a left adjoint? Well, if you're working with elliptic sheaves, from the way the theory is set up, it does always admit a left adjoint.
This is a map of arbitrary...
arbitrary free stacks.
So on the pre-stack, but still you're working with the category of affine schemes, so there's a finite type, or?
Yes, okay. Yes, yeah. When I write affine schemes, then there's a finite type.
Finite type
over your ground fields. Uh-huh. In this case, it's a cube. Happens to be always the point. And just as a matter of notation, let me introduce this. So if you go back to the projection to the point, call it py. Instead of writing py lower sheet, I'll write cohomology with compact supports. That's notation. And when I pull back from the point my QL, I'll just denote it by the dualizing notation. But now let's combine these two pieces of notation, and let's take the cohomology of compact supports of the dualizing. Do you guys have a name for it? No, it has a name. No. It starts with H. It's called homology. Yeah. Compact supports. Homology of the dualizing is homology. But now I will not, if I don't like letter H, I'll write letter C. I want to call it cochains because we are really in the
chains.
I put the lower star. We are in the higher world, so we're not taking individual cohomologies, but it's really kind of chains. All right. Now, going
to... F over shrink is between Y and Y2 or between the sheaf category 2? Yes. Okay. Because it's compatible with your two logical.
Thank you. All right.
So this left adjoint just exists by abstract limit kind of argument?
No, it follows formally from the fact that lower sheet exists for affine schemes.
Ah.
Just from there.
I see.
From there it's formal. All right. So why are you talking about
really some geometry then? That's
well, not, yeah.
Okay. Use
the entire theory of elliptic sheets. Just note that in this theory we don't have upper stars or lower stars. We have just the shrieks. Mm-hmm. If you want lower star, you have to say pay extra. So why am I talking about this? Well, because we want the run space.
We are quite far from Tamagawa.
We'll start going back. So we're at the highest point of the trajectory now, we start. All right. So we start with B, which is a commutative algebra in sheaves. And if you remember what we did with finite sets, we actually, from B, we produced another object. Let me call it factor B, which was actually a sheaf.
So these algebras are no longer unital?
They don't need to be unital. In our case, they happen to be unital, but they don't need to be. This unitality, non-unitality is the core of our work with Jacob. And I'll get to that discussion at the very end. So let's hold on to this. But I mean, it's unital, but you're forgetting the fact that it's unital. And we do it by the same procedure as in the case of finite sets, namely, the fiber, the sheet fiber of factor B at, let's say, just field valued points of the run space corresponding to just n tuple of points of the initial space X is the tensor product I of the Schwieg fibers of your initial B at these points, like we did in the finite set. Remember, it was bx1 times bx2. In the non-unital case.
Non-unital case.
Yeah.
But again, because you're taking wrong. Yeah.
Yeah. It might have a unit, just forget it.
Yeah.
Okay, and now, so...
So if it has a unit, the Schwieg fibers have a unit also?
They do.
Ah. Okay.
Finally, so the answer for this integral happens to be cohomology with compact supports over the Rong space of this vector B. So call it lambda. So I went to the older discussion to define, to construct this left adjoint. And here's what I'm saying. It's really kind of fancy, right? You have to go to this pre-stack and all this stuff, and you can't do otherwise. It's really kind of, you have no choice. You must do it. If you want explicit formula, you construct the Rong space. From your B, construct this sheaf on the Rong space vector B, and then take its cohomology.
You say homology or cohomology?
It's cohomology with compact support. It's the only thing that exists in our formalism.
No, because you're automology at all.
Ah. Homology is cohomology with compact support of the dualizing specifically.
So you have actually, you need enough machinery to actually prove that it makes sense. Otherwise, if you,
pardon?
You need enough machinery because all of those things are with higher things. So you need some nice machinery that allows you not to
start verifying. And we do have it. So we have the machinery now.
Okay.
So Lurie's higher algebra. Is that machinery.
Okay.
All right. So now let's go back to Tamagawa. So one step closer to Tamagawa. So let me just say that now a certain symbol will appear on the blackboard which hasn't been introduced. I wonder if you'll catch it. I'll take a very particular B. So, and I'll take a very particular C. Homology. I haven't introduced cohomology. What is that?
What do we think about that also?
All right. So I claim that homology of anything is naturally coalgebra. Therefore, its dual is an algebra.
But in which sense the dual?
We are in vect. Take the linear dual.
No, but the vect, according to what you said, includes direct.
Yeah, yeah. Rate. So it's a symmetric monoidal category. In there, it makes. There's operation of duality. There's operation of duality. It makes sense.
No, but you said that sometimes you take the int completion. So you take.
Yeah. It's infinite dimensional.
Okay. But the dual of an infinite dimensional guy is an inverse limit of the dual of the finite dimensional pieces.
Yeah. So yeah, but it's fine.
And so.
The dual of a coalgebra is nonetheless an algebra.
Yes. But not the converse.
Not the converse.
Ah, the dual of a coil, of course. It's an algebra just with a huge uncountable. Okay.
Perfect. However, it just so happens that each of these have finitely many, is finite dimensional, each cohomological degree. So that this duality is not as horrible as it would be in general.
Ah, So each cohomological degree is finite.
Yeah, but I don't care. It's formally given the definition, it makes sense. It's huge, but it's okay. All right, now I claim there's a map from B to C. So let's say very naively where it comes from as algebras. It means that for every point of the curve, I have a map from the cohomology of BG to the cohomology of BunG. Where does it come from? So for each point of the curve, I can map cochains on BG to cochains on BunG.
Evaluation
map. So you have a map from X times BunG to BG. So for each point of the curve, you have a map from BunG to BG, you have pullback and cohomology. So therefore, a junction. From here, we obtain a map from the
so that's where this product of all the BGs come from.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I should have said maybe, sorry. When I start with the sheaf of commutative algebras, the definition of what I mean by this is that. So that symbol that made no sense by definition means that.
But maybe you should also mention that it was in rational homotopy theory, and it was developed how to calculate homotopy type of space of maps from some C double complex small dimension to high connected space, yeah. I think she's sensing what you do.
Except in algebraic geometry.
Yes, yes.
Of course, this is what we do.
Yes, it's.
But in algebraic geometry, it doesn't work except when X is a curve and the target is BG.
Because it's stopped with four dimensions. Yeah.
Infinitely, it makes sense. It always works.
No. Dimension
should be
less and it's.
Right, correct. But in algebraic geometry, you have.
Dimension 2 of curve?
Yeah. But if you start with the surface, there's nothing.
Much. Yes, it's still not converging.
So, a junction. So you get a map from here. And now I state the real theorem. By the way, this map makes sense when X is an arbitrary algebraic variety, G is an arbitrary group whatsoever. And now X is a curve. And G is simply connected. Then
and semi-simple.
Sorry, semi-simple, simply connected. Otherwise, well,
it doesn't make sense.
Then the map is an isomorphism. Right. And this theorem has a name. This is the Atiyah-Bott formula. Of course, they didn't write it like this because at the time there was no round space or anything like that. However, the left-hand side, although it looks very fancy, it can be computed very explicitly, and when you compute it very explicitly, in terms of the cohomology of BG.
So is this the paper?
Yes, it's that paper.
But they work over C.
Yes, they proved it over complex numbers, and they proved it by the method that Maxime is talking about. It was they gave an differential geometric proof. So
it's analysis. Okay.
Yes, it was it was analytic proof, basically along the lines as Maxime was explaining. But the statement, if you write it in this form, it makes sense in general, and it holds an arbitrary ground field. It holds algebra geometrically. So this is the kind of the real assertion, and as a corollary. So, once you have that, you can from it formally takes, well, it needs some work, but numerical product formula. So, if you take the trace of the Frobenius on both sides, you actually arrive to the product formula that I wrote before. That's the product of traces of inverse Frobenius is on the cohomologies of these things will be the trace of the inverse Frobenius on the cohomology of, well, on this. Okay, and so I mean, the real work is here. So the question is, how much time do I have?
5 minutes?
5 minutes.
So, and why you get exactly the product instead of those finite? Before we said that you get something, we had the product over finite sets, subsets of sets.
Yeah, but you can see the product of things which is 1 plus something.
Yes.
If you have infinite product, you can write it sum over infinite or finite subsets. Taking from product of 1 plus some numbers.
Yes, but this means it is 1 plus something and the 1 is out. But here the
there's a little bit of work required here. And I'm not saying it's immediately evident.
But you are still taking things which have unit or not? The C upper star VG as a unit?
Yes. So the way we deduce it is as follows. So we actually rewrite it, the left-hand side, the way that Atiyah and Bott rewrote it. It's actually... it's a symmetric algebra on something, and we calculate and see. I can.
Okay.
So maybe, if you want, in question time, I can write the Atiyah-Bott formula, say what that thing is explicitly, and from there deduce, show how to deduce this.
Okay.
So in the remaining now 3 minutes, I can try to say how we prove this. So it also, well, it requires proof. It's not like. So, if you wish, this is a local-to-global principle. We're saying that, so the left-hand side is essentially local. We assemble from finite subsets of the curve. And the right-hand side is global. It really has to do with the kind of automorphic objects, Banji. So, something needs to be done. And so it doesn't come for free. So let me say what the key geometric ingredient is. We introduce this gadget called the finder's manion. But it's the wrong version. Again, I don't have time now, I'll be happy to add more details in question time. So it's the moduli space of a bundle equipped with a rational trivialization. And there is this map that forgets the rational trivialization. And it also projects the one space, which says that, away from which sets you have the rational trivialization. So the key geometric result is that the homology, so this map is homology, is a homology equivalence. So this map is locally a product, so basically every bundle admits a rational trivialization. What it says is that for a given bundle, the space of rational trivializations is homologically trivial. That is to say that the space of rational functions from a curve, which is a horrible, but manageable pre-stack, imagine, we're really talking about the space of rational functions, you can make sense of it as a pre-stack, rational maps from the curve to the G, to the group G. You can make sense of it, you can actually calculate its homology and prove that it's trivial. It's what we call homologically contractible.
Is it contractible?
It is.
Yeah, not just yeah. Normal. Yeah.
It's actually... yeah. And...
but the space of maps from a point to G is not contractible.
Not at all.
But rational maps is no point.
Yeah.
But rational map includes constants maps.
Including. But that's okay.
Yeah, you've got more room.
Yeah. So I can tell you the reason. I mean, again, I'll be happy to comment how that comes about. And this is specific to dimension one. So none of that would be true if it was either lower dimension, as you say, point, or surface. It's really kind of the same.
So what is the definition of the round Grassmannian over a base S? It's bundles on S cross X.
I'll say that in a second. So maybe I think I have to officially finish because it's 11:05, and then I'll answer this and everything else. Shall we do that?
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. Thank you. Okay, so we will take a few questions. So maybe we start as usual, Tokyo, then Beijing, and then Paris. Okay, so Tokyo.
Do you have some questions? Any questions? Yeah, it's similar to nobody has a question in
okay.
Tokyo. Sorry.
Beijing, do you have some questions?
Just go ahead.
Go ahead. Oh, yeah, so it's a question. So it says a paper by Franco and Go where they propose a geometric version of the trace formula. And the Atiyah-Bott formula, yes, occurs at the spectral sign of the trace formula. So do you see there's a possible connection between this proof of Tamagawa number and the proposal of geometric trace form?
Good question. The answer is I don't know. I haven't studied that paper in sufficient detail. I should do it. Just thanks for the suggestion.
Yeah, because in the number field case, Tamagawa number contingent, of course, is proof as a consequence of the trace form consideration. So it seems that there should be a connection there. Maybe in the formula field case, the trace formula, as I say, is interpreted as a consequence of the Atiyah-Bott fixed formula, the proven that's a trace form.
Okay, I'll go and look. I haven't, so I'll do it.
Other questions from Beijing?
Can you say a word on the proof of the left-hand trace formula for bungee?
Yeah, you mean, so how do I deal with these infinitive, right, with convergence?
Yeah.
So, it's a reduction theory. So, let's deal with SL2, okay, just for an example. So how does bungee for SL2 look like? Well, it looks as follows. You can take an open piece, which are bundles which are not very unstable. Yeah. You take bundles which are not very unstable. Well, in general, bungee is stratified by the degree of instability. There are semi-stable bundles. And then for each integer n, there are bundles that look as follows. So they are extensions of where L has degree specifically M. M is a positive integer. And so this act looks very, very simple. It's, well, it's a stack of extensions of this by this. And, well, you explicitly see, and then you sum up over all integers and you get geometric series. So on each stratum, so basically what happens is bungee looks as a finite union of geometric series. And that's how you control it. So in other words, you prove for stacks of for algebraic stacks of finite type, and in this case, this guy, it's not a finite type, but it's, again, a finite union of things like look something like finite type, time something looks like a geometric series. When I say geometric series, I mean it's 1 over an, point over an. Well, this is a fine translation group. And when you count points, you literally get geometric series.
You mean the classifying space of an?
there's vice space. So these, as you vary, vary the degree.
Okay. Other questions from Beijing?
No more questions.
Okay. Thank you. So, questions, interest?
Run space. So first of all, there is a result that I think I heard in some seminar, but I don't remember exactly. So the fact that the bundles are rationally trivial, but also over a base, that is locally for the Atiyah topology, they are rationally trivial on the total space, yes?
Right.
There is some result like this.
Drinfeld-Simpson.
Who?
Drinfeld-Simpson.
Drinfeld-Simpson?
Yeah.
And now, the rationally trivial in this context means trivial outside the scheme, which is finite over the base, or outside?
So in this case, so when the group is simply connected, it's much, much stronger than that. It says that if you take any non-empty divisor.
Yes.
On the
pardon? On the curve.
On the curve.
Then after an Atiyah-Bott change of your scheme of parameters, it becomes trivial outside of the divisor.
Ah, okay.
For simply connected, for semi-simple, it means it's, sorry, for semi-simple, this is true.
For semi-simple bundles, okay, for constant groups, you mean?
Okay, so this is proved for constant groups. For group schemes, it's proved only in our paper with Jacob, and it's proved in the simply connected case.
And again, outside a given.
Yes, you specify a section, and after a Atiyah-Bott change of the scheme of parameters, the thing trivializes outside the given section.
So now, concerning the definition of Grassmannian run.
Yes.
Can you say what it is?
Yes, absolutely. So first of all, I said that it maps to here and to here. So I better, if I want to S point to this, I have to specify point of here and point of here.
Yes.
So home from S to Grassmannian 1 is the following. First of all, it's a PG, it's a G bundle on S times X. It's a point, S point of bundle G. Also, it's a finite subset in home from S. And now it specifies my crucial Grassmannian type datum. I specify a trivialization, P0G is a trivial bundle, on X times X without, when I remove a certain divisor. Which divisor? I take the union of the graphs.
Okay.
So I run through this finite set I. For each element, I take the map from S to X. I take this graph, throw it out.
Okay, so this roughly explains this, and then there is another vague question, excuse me for this, but still, the what concerning this integral of those px upper roof, upper shriek of c star bg on the, so we work there with tensor product of seeing whichever you need, but yeah, so I want to understand roughly why it is like what Koncevich stated about the product of plus 1 plus alpha I is 1 plus finite product.
It's a great question. So, no. First of all, literally, when you take the finite set, you get exactly that. If X is a finite set,
yes.
But the way this integral is defined, remember, integral is cohomology with compact support of what I call factor F.
That is the cohomology of the guy, which is.
I wonder if we should.
We should maybe take another question. Then.
Should I answer or first question? Or should I?
Yeah.
Okay. So again, the integral is by definition cohomology with compact supports on the one. If X is a finite set,
yes.
You literally get what Maxim said. Because factor B, what is it? So let's say, suppose X is a finite two-element set.
Yes.
What's factor B? Well, Ron, in this case, is disjoint union of three elements. It's
yes.
1, 2, and 1, 2.
Yes.
And what's factor B? So you get B1,
yes.
B2, B1 tensor B2.
Yes.
And cohomology with contact supports is just direct sum.
Ah, okay, so you get the. Okay, and then how this is the product for?
1 plus B1 times 1 plus B2.
How this is the product for?
So you're asking, why do I call this quotation product, tensor product in quotation marks?
So then you want to get something which is the numerical product formula, which was actually a product formula.
Okay, so maybe we should terminate I'll answer this.
Okay, except if you can say just in a few words. It will take time.
Pardon?
You cannot answer just in a few words.
Yeah, it is.
Okay, so maybe we take another question. There is no other questions. Okay, then we will say goodbye, since it should be now 7 p.m. in Tokyo. Yeah, exactly, we need to go to the professor. Okay, so goodbye, and see you in 1 month.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.